Hello, everybody, and welcome to OGT Live, our first like Wednesday meeting that is live with all of our members. I'm joined with my wife, Mallory.
Hi.
So this is going to be an awesome show. Really excited about this one. And we get to smoke a fantastic cigar. So all those a part of the membership, you have this cigar. We're going to be smoking it tonight. Don't know if you smoked it yet. I know that we have smoked several of them.
Yeah, just a few.
Yeah, probably smoked a little bit too many. But we're going to go ahead and get this lit up. This month's drop was Year of the Smoky Lizard. This is a 6x52 Habano 2000, and it comes from Nicaragua. It has a double binder and fillers from Nicaragua as well. I really love this cigar. As usual, I not only invite you, but please do encourage. Drop down in the comments what your thoughts are on the cigar as we smoke it together. Flavor notes you might be getting, comments, questions. I will pull them up as they go. Just it makes it more interesting. And again, this is a virtual HERF. So we're all hanging out together. Virtual cigar lounge, as it were. So we're going to go ahead and get this lit up. We've got Charles Owens. Hello, all. Thank you, Charles, for jumping on. So usually we do this on the first Thursday of every month at the shop. But thought it would be better if we actually do it the first Wednesday a little bit earlier than normal. That way, people back east, it's not going into 10 or 11. And usually on Thursdays, she can't join me. So
yeah,
it's good to find you have live.
Yeah, this is really nice.
Yeah. And you know, I'm just going to go ahead and get this lit up. Like I said, if anyone smoked this before, drop down in the comments your thoughts. I don't know if anything strikes you right first on light up.
I have not. I lit about halfway and then chickened out. So okay. I'm gonna grab that from you and
give it a try. We're gonna afterwards. Go and get this lit.
Okay.
There we go. Something I love about this cigar that, I mean, I say a lot on some cigars that I look for is the smoke output. And generally, this has a really good smoke output. Good construction. Draw is on point. Jim is on. Jim, how you doing? Good to see you jumping on.
All right. I'll catch up to you.
We got Mitch on as well. So a little bit of... like a little bit of pepper on the top. It's just enough to be like complimentary. It's not like crazy strong or anything like that, but it's a really good like supportive like pepper spice to it.
Ooh, draw on this one's really, really good. I mean, I like all of them so far, but.
So when I think of something that hits the criteria of if we're going to have it in the society, there's several things that really going to have to like pass the bar. And I think construction smoke output is definitely in there. You can't just release something that's like, it's not going to perform. That's a big part of it. Mm-hmm. And You're the Smoky Lizard, I feel like, has that in spades.
Yeah.
When it comes to it. Let's see here. We got a Matthew on saying, newer to the cigar scene, but loving the society and loving my first OGT cigar drop. Appreciate all the content I am learning.
Thanks for joining us.
Yes. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you for joining on. That's awesome. We got Jason. Hello, Jason. Mallory and Eric. It's cold tonight. I know you're probably smoking outside. I apologize for that. But yeah, so Year of the Smoky Lizard. People might think it's a bit confusing with the name. Actually, this cigar, I can't take credit for naming. This was actually named by Mallory. Where did this name come from?
Well, I feel like you should kind of tell the whole story because I don't know.
So if any of you guys follow, like Cigar News and some of the stuff happening, Gurkha has a copyright on the name Dragon. Now, rewind like backward, and actually, I don't know if you mind, Mallory, taking this. Sorry, guys, we're getting a call real quick from the shop. Okay. She's going to go ahead and take that. I'm going to give you a bit of backstory. So when it comes to this, the name Dragon, Gurkha has apparently a copyright on this name. Now, in the background, Davidoff Cigars has always done the Year of the Cigar, Year of the Rabbit, Year of the Ox, Year of the whatever. They've been doing this for a very long time. They're kind of the OG company that started the Year of Cigar, the lunar year. And so this year was Year of the Dragon. So Gurkha thought, you know what, we might as well try to cash in on this. And they ended up filing a lawsuit against Davidoff Cigars because of the name Dragon in Year of the Dragon. So that was kind of going on in the background, as I understand it, because there's several other companies that have Dragon cigars out there. Either they slipped under the radar or they ended up like settling with Gurkha to get the copyrights to put the Year of the Cigar, the Year Dragon on there. So it's a bit unclear of who's actually done that. What I will say, I think it's a little unfortunate is that Davidoff having to go through that, since we know Davidoff, this is what they do every year. It's what they've done from the beginning. It's been kind of their MO. And so this year, we wanted to kind of do something different on the OGT line. So we said, what if we do our own year of, we're not going to do the dragon. We're not going to poke the bear on that, but we can kind of give a nod into that realm as well. And then you came up with the name Smoky Lizard. I think originally I said year of the winged lizard or something like that.
Yeah, Smoky Lizard sounded funnier. So, I mean, I'm down for doing all the Zodiac ones with funny names. I already have like one lined up for next year.
So. Yeah. Well, and there's a two nod.
I don't know if he's going to let me do it though.
Well, so, yeah. We'll get to that part as well. But there's a two way nod to this. You have Smoky Lizard, which is one, dragons are smoky, and the cigar is smoky.
Yeah.
It just fit better.
Right.
So when you said that, I was like, all right, that's a better idea.
Thank you.
It's better than mine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes.
So what is next year's?
Danger Scarf.
But what's the actual year?
Year of the Snake.
We'll see if we get to Danger Scarf. We'll see if that happens.
Hey, let us know.
Drop down in the comments.
That's a great idea, and we need to do it.
If we're looking at Year of the Snake, does Year of the what is it? Dangerous Scarf?
Danger Scarf.
Or Year of the something else? Kind of work in that vein. We got a few comments here. I'm going to go ahead and pull this up. We got Jack on. Cheers, all. Getting set up. Well, thank you for joining us tonight. Blackbeard Cigars. Love the smoke output. 100%. And we actually talked about this on our podcast the other night. It's like, it's not a requirement. Like when you smoke a cigar, it's not like it has to have heavy smoke output. But I think cigar smokers would agree. It's most satisfying when it is.
I feel like with my attention span and stuff, I definitely prefer the really smoky ones because I have a tendency if I'm like talking to you or someone else, like, I will smoke too hard and too fast. Like if there's not a ton of smoke, like it's just like a sensory thing where I'm like,
you're like chasing it.
Yeah. I'm like chasing a larger smoke cloud. And oftentimes that's me ruining a cigar because I'm trying to get that. So it's nice when you don't have to do that.
Right. Right. It's that added bonus we all look for. This cigar though, in terms of draw, smoke output and like flavor, it's just every time I smoke, I'm like, it's a joy to smoke.
Yeah.
It's not overbearing. It's not wispy to where I'm like, I wish there was like, there's like no flavor going on or there's no strength going on. It has just like the right amount, which is really cool.
And it's one of those things where, you know, when you're prepping to like send out the packages and everything else, like, it's kind of hard not to talk about it with people. Like
it's true.
When you're like, you've been trying them constantly. Cause you're like, that one, I gotta smoke that one. And there's something wrong with it. I'm pretty sure.
Right. I think it's damaged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Double check.
So we got Jack saying, love the name. Awesome. Texas Taurus is on. I figured Evil Bong was going to be in there somewhere. We still have not watched this movie. Let's see here. Liking the name, stands out. Okay.
All right. So yes.
In there. Mitch is saying, yes, Danger Scarf.
See?
Oh, this is getting a little dangerous.
I need to come on here more often and get my opinions validated. Okay.
As we got Texas Taurus. I'll tune in since it's been a while. It has been a little while. And we've got Kyle Gray. Well.
Hey.
Look at the beautiful couple smoking one hell of a cigar. And I've got to give a shout out to people like Kyle, people like Chris out there, Daniel, Mitch out there. A lot of the I've gotten a really good feedback from the cigar, and I'm really happy to hear that. The feedback really helps kind of to navigate like what cigars do we have in the works and what's kind of the flavor profile. It seems for the most part, most of the members are kind of on that medium to like full strength level, medium to full body.
Yeah.
So I would say personally, I feel like this cigar is medium strength, full in body, full in flavor. Like it doesn't knock you out.
No, I would say it's not a knock you on your butt,
mm-hmm.
but the flavor, the flavor intensity, I would say is
right.
Yeah. Complexity. I think it seems like it has transitions. It's like, it's not like you're picking out 20 different flavors while you're smoking initially.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like there's good, strong, interesting flavors in each third, but it's more like, the complexity happens across that as opposed to.
Right. You can notice the journey of the cigar.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It has a good cohesive note to it. Really pleasant as well. But I would agree. And it kind of is a cigar that knows what it is and performs very well with that. Let's see here. Kyle is saying, I shared one with my friend, and you know I don't share my OGT monthly cigars.
That's nice of you.
Well, awesome. I definitely hope he enjoyed it. We got Charles saying, great respite from pouring rain, an amazing smoke, and a nice beverage to keep the bones warm. Yeah, nice. It's a bit cold. It's a bit cold out here. Let's see, Jack saying, smoke, Western neck tie.
Snake, Western neck tie.
Oh, so there you go. But I dig the dangerous scarf too. Western necktie is not bad either.
Yeah.
Not bad either. So it was, some good names.
You need a cowboy necktie.
Yeah, there you go. Cowboy necktie.
Oh.
We've got a year to figure it out.
Yeah.
No. But it's also got to like fit right. Like the name for this cigar, I think, was so easy because it lended itself to how the cigar performs.
Yeah. Well, and I think we talked about wanting to do something with like a neon band, something to kind of something fun for like the kind of dreary months too. I think that that is like, I tend to lean towards like, it's, you know, with that bright like label and stuff too. And it's like, it's got personality, you know?
It does. So it does. Now, nice I will too. Also say, while I make the videos and such like that, the band itself was actually designed and created by Mallory. She did the entire thing. What I really think is a subtlety about the band that I enjoy is that each band has a gradient color. So it's a bit different. I mean, well, I'm going to go ahead and pull up a picture here so you guys can kind of see. You can see the gradient color and that changes from like band to band five pack. So instead of getting the five pack of the exact same, you have that gradient color. It's a really cool thing. So
kind of fun.
I have to say, well done. It came out very good.
Thank you. Thank you. You didn't trust me at first.
I trusted you.
Yeah.
The thing is, what really works is that we will, as anyone does, working together, family, there are disagreements. But I think at this point,
we didn't fight over it.
We don't fight, but we have a difference of opinion. But we've kind of learned each other's language in terms of like, this feels right. Like, you're the smoky lizard feels right. We're going to go with that.
The aesthetic language. It's funny. I think we actually kind of share an aesthetic language. I think that that even like translates to the shop where... Austin. Okay, hold on. Ostentatious ascot is a good one.
That's really good, Kyle. That's not bad at all.
But it should have three S's. Ostentatious ascot.
That's not bad at all. Jack is saying the band on this is perfect. It came out blended in so well, but stands out at the same time.
Thank you.
I am stoked that you guys shared the backstory on this and was wondering why it wasn't Dragon. It's
tongue in cheek.
So I've also, it's very tongue in cheek. And I've got to give a shout out to a friend of mine who runs Cigars Daily, Tim Swanson, because he saw our email and he sent me a text laughing, saying he's like, this is a great way to go around it. Because you get the point across, and it's not like we're not trying to
steal anything either. It's stealing, more like,
yeah, or stir the pot or anything, but it kind of works.
Just kind of have fun with what's happening in the industry.
Yeah.
I was going to say, we share an aesthetic language, but sometimes the way we describe things verbally doesn't always connect. So like when I'm like, I want to put a dragon from a, 1920s book illustration on this cigar, your immediate thought is like, oh, that's not gonna look the way, you know, like it's gonna look flat or it's gonna look. And so I was like, well, just trust me until you see it, because you have to see it, because I'm not good at explaining what I mean, but I know what
you're pretty good at explaining. I would definitely say I think too though that there's an element like when you work on a project for so long and like, okay, with the cigars, and we're getting to the point that when you start giving out ideas and working on the computer, I'm like, you know what? It's much better if I just like leave and see the finished product, because it's so much off of my back. I'm like, I don't have to worry about it. It's now in your hands and I can move on to the next thing until we come back.
You're really great about like not micromanaging it at all. I think the only thing is sometimes like, what if we made it red? Every time it's, what if we made it red?
There's a lot of red.
You do like red.
And burgundy.
Yeah.
And such. Now, and I will say out of the gradient, I find that the darker ones, I personally enjoy a lot.
Yeah,
I think that they come out good. We got Raider Dave saying, along with how great the cigar smokes and tastes, the band is beautiful. When I picked them up, I asked Eric who designed the band, and I knew it was Mallory. It's bold, aww, but the nice feminine touch. Great job.
Thank you.
And there's that added element to it as well. There's the extra eye, and especially when you're smoking different cigars in the industry and you're kind of watching some of the social media and the patterns all that. It's kind of cool to have a fresh eye separate to be like, let's just not follow suit. Let's make it look really aesthetically pleasing. And you have that.
Thank you. Thanks, bud.
Now, anyone watching, we're going to kind of get into the blend itself as much as I can talk about the factory. But if you get the opportunity, please do like and comment and subscribe and share the video. It really helps us fight the algorithm that we're dealing with. And it goes a long way. So if you guys get the opportunity or you feel so inclined, we got Mitch saying Tim is a good guy. Now going to be a grandpa. Great podcast. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, definitely. Definitely. It's always good to jump on his stuff. We got Gabriel on. Evening, folks. Thank you for joining on. So we're about an inch in. Now, I've said this before, and I've talked to Mallory about this as well. This is the second time we've had a cigar from the society where I can't actually name the blender. And it's so funny because, I mean, of course, it's the same blender. It's the same factory. And the first time it happened is we released it from Renfield. So anyone who got their hands on Renfield were able to smoke that Halloween exclusive. This comes from the same factory. And actually, oddly enough, this was rolled back in September, October, around that time as well. So it's got a good amount of age. But I was typing up the article for Renfield, like literally typing it up, and I'm texting back and forth the manufacturer, asking them, comparing notes. And then the last thing they say to me is, by the way, don't mention our name publicly. And I always thought it was a sales pitch. Like, you hear that, it's like, oh, it's just a gimmick.
Yeah.
It's a way to be, like, mysterious. But it's true. They don't want to be mentioned.
So the Smoky Lizard is very mysterious on top of everything else.
Very mysterious. And so I can't really name that. What I can say, it's a straight to factory source. While I really enjoy spotlighting brands like when we've done stuff with Paul Stulak, when we've released stuff with Cigar Clowns and Sheffield, like I like to show, like, here's another cigar great that this company
did. Like to point back to the craftsmanship and stuff.
Yeah. The unique aspect about this in Renfield, which I also enjoy, this is straight to the source factory. It's not a brand. It's not a separate company. This is just the tobacco this factory has. And I mean, for me personally, it was my number one vote. Renfield just knocked it out of the park. I love that cigar. That's a good cigar. That is an incredible cigar. And so to have them come back with this, and let's see, yeah, it's got about between 5 and 6 months of age. I think it's aged beautifully. The burn on it is just, construction is on point with this cigar. I'm a huge fan. Let's see here. Jason saying, say the band is visually amazing. Awesome. Awesome. And Kyle saying, whoop, whoop, the Rennie. Great smoke. Awesome. Yeah. And speaking of cigars that got a lot of recognition, we are 2 days out, from dropping our Bleak Midwinter 2 cigar. The first one was our number 4 cigar of the year last year. This year, we've changed it up a little bit. It's, to me, a bit more complex, a bit more sweeter tones to it. I like how that's got the Candela foot that we added as well. And you have it play with, like, Candela grassy, creamy, sweet with the wrapper leaf and the filler that is, like, spicy, peppery. It's a really good mixture. And same size, same wrapper leaf, but different blend. So this drops on Friday at 7 o'clock. I'm super excited. I know that you've smoked a lot of these.
A lot of them. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're good.
I mean, you got quality control.
I do like that Candela.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice.
Well, and I feel like it's almost a tradition at this point. If you're a cigar smoker, you want to smoke something Candela on St. Patty's Day. Like, it's just kind of there. Mm-hmm. This, I feel like it fulfills two things. One, you have that tradition upheld. And two, it really is awesome to taste that transition from Candela, like, because it's closed foot, you don't toast it, you go straight into it. And then it morphs into that Maduro leaf, and it's right on point. Right on point. I'm really looking forward to that drop. Let's see here. Jack's saying the pre-light draw is outstanding. Awesome. I would agree. Right on point with draw and such like that. Kyle's saying, take my money. It's a great cigar. I can't wait to get that out to you. And are those stickers available too? Unfortunately, the stickers, not as much. They're more of like a bundle situation. We have the cigars, just not as much stickers this time around.
We need to work on our merch.
Mm-hmm. Like, which there are some really cool hats coming for Oakland Tobacconist, and they will be made available as soon as they come in.
That's exciting.
Really cool. But let's talk a little bit about flavor notes, as we usually do on Society Night. Go ahead and take a puff, smoke the cigar, kind of see what anything's jumping out, what kind of flavors. I'm going to do the same. I don't know for you if there's anything that's standing out in particular.
It's funny because I think it's harder almost to come back after I've smoked it a lot, kind of not absentmindedly, but just without paying close attention, and be like, okay, am I just imagining this or is this just this day? But like, I get a little bit of like a bready note at this point. And I got some sandalwood just a minute ago, which I don't normally get on this dark of a cigar. Like, I've gotten it more on Connecticut, like the light.
Sure.
You know what I'm talking about? Like, not as much with this, but I did get like a whiff of like sandalwood on like the retro. But
yeah. Yeah, no, I definitely think there's that woody, the breadiness for sure for me as well. Almost a citrusy note. Now, not citrus as in when you think of like super lemony or such, but almost like the like a lemon skin or something like that.
Okay.
I kind of feel
like just that tiny bit of acid.
Yeah.
Yeah. I could see that. I think that is what makes it taste kind of clean to me, is that little bit of acid on the finish. It's lighter in that way.
Yes.
Like still very strong flavors, but like that finish is light.
And I would say there's some earthiness to this as well, but that kind of offsets it. I know that you, if it's too musty and earthy, it's not your thing.
Earthy, it's like, it really depends. Like if we say like grandma's basement or Home Depot garden center.
Yeah.
I like that kind of earthy. But like the barnyard funk.
Right, right.
That you talk about is, no, thank you.
There's some really good barnyard cigars out there, like I gotta say. Let's see. We got some tasting notes from Kyle here. We're going to pull this in. Earthy, bready notes, 100%, but also dried fruit or floral at the end of the retro.
I can see the floral too. That may have been what I was interpreting as sandalwood.
Yeah, definitely. And there are, it's kind of a fullness in flavor. Like it covers that deeper, earthy, mid bready notes. And then, yeah, a little bit of sweetness on the back end for sure. The burn is great and the ash is on point. I'm getting the pith of a lemon. There you go. Maybe it's the pith. There's something in there. It's not like when you bite into a lemon, but it's like the residual of something. Jack is saying, wow, the retrohale is on this is insane. Like spicy tartiness. That's a good way to explain it. A little bit of tart almost.
Okay. This might sound crazy, but I think I have a thought, because you know the syrup that I pour on the baklava? That's got orange and cinnamon.
Yes.
That's a little bit what I'm getting, where it's like that orange isn't like in your face, because there's some lemon in there too. Right?
Okay. Yeah.
But it like, because of the cinnamon, it kind of mellows it.
I definitely see that.
Do you get that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like similar effect. I don't know. It was really weird. As a kid, we used to have like cord, like orange wedges with cinnamon on it, and it kind of like cuts that acidic citrus down, kind of similar type of vibe. Let's see. Omega Forever, good evening, glad to be a part of the OGT family. Thank you so much for joining on. Light up the Smoky Lizard, smoke along with us, glad you're jumping on here. See, Mitch is saying Kyle hit the nail on the head. Get different notes when it was 75 degrees out. My barnyard smells like sheep, but lamb chops are great tasting.
Love
there
lamb.
You go.
Lamb is good.
From now on, I will only describe the notes as cigar as essence of Home Depot.
I mean, it's apt. I don't know how to, I don't, you know.
It's okay. So it's funny. At the shop, we talk about earthy notes a lot.
Yeah.
And I think as a cigar smoker, notes like earth, wood, cocoa, coffee, those are like some pepper. Those are really common notes.
Yeah.
And they're very ones you can latch onto. There's a guy at our shop, I love this guy, but he was very skeptical when I said earthy. He's like, what, have you tasted dirt? And I'm like, who hasn't tasted dirt?
I mean,
like, you were you never a kid and played outside and like,
yeah. I mean,
it's kind of forever in the register.
I don't know. I mean, like, I always bring this up, so forgive me if I'm repeating myself, but you know that thing where they talk about how, because when you're a little kid, you taste everything with your mouth, like you lick everything, right? As like a toddler, little baby, like that you can look in a room and you know what the taste and texture is of everything in that room.
Yeah.
And you can't explain it, like you don't know why,
but you know what it feels like,
what, like, you know, that tastes like, you know what I mean? But like, you know.
Yeah.
Like, so you know what dirt tastes like, because you can smell dirt, and also probably you ate it as a baby.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. There's, it's funny because no, it's totally true. It's in the register. It's like your mind.
Cataloged it.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter when, it's just there.
And it doesn't go away, especially when it's a kid, when you're a kid. Mm-hmm. When we were building the humidor, like all of our, the entire walls of the humidor is covered in an inch thick Spanish cedar. Mm-hmm. So very, very thick Spanish cedar, but it was all rough cut when it showed up. So I had to cut and straighten every single plank. And I was like spitting cedar for like a week. So when I'm like, this tastes like cedar, that will never go away.
Yep.
Like it was in my nose. It was everywhere. But,
well, I used to garden as a little kid too. So there's that very much like that kind of earth doesn't like, but it's anytime you get that, I hesitate to say moldy but there is a musty taste that you get on some cigars that some people love in the same way that some people love funky cheese. Mm-hmm. Like I don't mind funky cheese. I just don't like it in my cigar tasting notes. But
sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
There is a cigar that just the room note, you can smell it, has like a blue cheese aspect to it. And there's a lot of guys at the shop, they're like, I'm looking for a cigar that gives like blue cheese. Ugh. So this was crazy though. It's to me, it's so distinctive. I walk into the lounge today. No one has a cigar in their hand because they kind of just showed up and someone had smoked a cigar on the way up. And I was like, I haven't seen anything, but I'm curious who smoked this cigar. And someone's like, oh, I just finished it. And I was like, I could tell. I smelled the entire.
You're the Sherlock Holmes of cigar notes.
No, it's just so distinctive. I'm like, that's what that cigar is. It's very interesting. Let's see here.
I can tell by the mud on your boots.
Exactly. The retro is very enjoyable. Sweet sourdough. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Mitch is saying Lowe's.
Oh, the different tasting. Note.
It is. It's a different. Okay.
We
it's
need
a
to
different
release
earthiness.
An April Fool's. Case only the society will be in on it. But all of Mallory's weird tasting notes.
That's true.
Like I said, Dr. Pepper one time and chocolate covered honeycomb. And what was the other one? There's
some
few.
Of them are right
Rose.
On point.
I've gotten Rose and I was correct. You know, so, but that's not one
and
of
then
the
we'll,
ones.
And then if we ever have a cigar that's like, people are like, you know what? This wasn't really good. And we're like, yeah, it tastes like cigar aficionado. no, we won't release that cigar. Don't worry. Let's see here. Adam, hey, how's it going, man? Said, can't wait to try one out when I am in Cali. Definitely. Good to see you. Hope you're doing well out there. See, Jason's saying the smell of plastic from a new toy, best childhood smell.
That's also the tennis balls smell, too. Mm. Like the tennis balls, they talk about that in Psalm, where the guy's like, it smells like garden hose or tennis balls.
Yeah.
I have tasted that on a cigar before, too.
Yeah. So. There's some of it never leaves. Dang, that's when you get to know you are on point. Oh, sorry. It was probably on the notes earlier on. Yeah. Let's see here. What is that? Olfactory?
Olfactory ties so many smells or essences to memories, and that ties to things you love or hate, but very true when talking about how palates mature.
Yeah.
Yeah.
100%. I remember we were doing a tasting night, and we were smoking an AJ cigar. It was a Habano, and I was like, people are going to give me crap for this, and they're like, what are you tasting? And I'm like, there's a note of peanut butter on this, and this was like three or four people I'm talking to, and they're like, what is this? What is this? And then someone on the other side of the lounge is like, I'm kind of getting peanut butter. And I was like, yes, exactly. And the person turned to me and they're like, you're not full of shit. I'm like, look, I'm not making it up. It's palates are subjective, different tastes and such. And sometimes it's what you register. Let's see here. Jack is saying, I am getting the lemon peel now, but like raspberry lemon peel. Okay. Yeah. There's something in there. And so I'm approaching the second third here. It almost in body is intensifying, I feel like. Mm-hmm. More concentrated flavor, a little more peppery, which I really enjoy. Nothing bores me more than a mild Habano cigar that has a little bit, like a twinge of spice, and that immediately goes away like a centimeter in, and then it just gets sweet and light and boring. Like that's always like, oh, I've got to get through this cigar. So the journey of it is really important. But we're at the halfway mark, and I wanted this episode to also be somewhat educational. So what we're going to be adding on the first Wednesday of every month, as we meet as a society, we're going to tackle one major news event that has happened in the cigar industry. This is one that some of you guys have probably heard about happening. I think it took place, I want to say it was Saturday or Sunday. So a little bit has passed, but I want to talk about a company that we've actually featured before. We have in the humidor, and that is Caldwell Cigar Company. Don't know if you guys have smoked anything from them before. Robert Caldwell is the founder of the company. They've worked with factories like Adventura in the Dominican. They've worked with a few other. They've also worked with like AJ, Drew Estate, Matt Booth at one time. They're kind of like the OG. Well, not the OG, but one of them.
One of the OG, like
super like underground boutique companies.
Yeah, like cult classic. Cult yeah. Following.
And I know that like when I started smoking, when was that? About like 11 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And you would like, hey, what do you want for Christmas? That's usually Caldwell came up in
yeah,
name.
Caldwell did come up. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And from a artistic standpoint, you always like their graphic
Primo.
Design. Yeah.
Primo.
So the company, when I think of Caldwell, I always think of really rich flavor. Strength-wise, mild to medium. Mm-hmm. There's not many out there. They did a cigar called All Out Kings, which was a favorite of mine.
I remember that.
And that was between Drew Estate, Caldwell, and no, just those two. Then they did one called The Tea, which I love.
Yep.
That was AJ and Matt Booth and him. So a bunch of different such like that. Well, there's another company out there that distributes primarily pipe tobacco and pipes. They distribute Savinelli pipes, Peterson, Cornell and Deal pipe tobacco called Laudacy Distribution Group. They actually distribute the pipes that we sell at the shop. They recently acquired Caldwell Cigars. They purchased them.
Mm-hmm.
This is, I would say, like the third like big one that I feel like in the last couple of years. You had General, or I should say STG, buying out Mount Booth.
Mm-hmm.
And then you had also General purchasing Alec Bradley. Those acquisitions took place. This is an interesting one.
That is interesting because it's like those are more like, you know, when bigger beer companies go in and buy smaller beer companies, you
yeah.
get kind of the same genre, right? And they mm-hmm. might still distribute the same beer, you know what I mean? But they're just buying them up, you know what I mean? Whereas
right.
it's a little different when it's a pipe company.
It is. It is. And it's not only segregated to just Caldwell, because they also own Lost and Found, uh-huh. and Laudacy also acquired Lost and Found.
So is that like them making a move in the industry to like broaden out what they...
So speculation speaking, because I don't fully know, here's what I do think, is that there's another pipe tobacco company called Sutliff.
Mm-hmm.
And Sutliff is also a distribution group, and they distribute a lot of cigar brands like okay. Drunk Chicken, Matilde, Veritas, I think they had for a while.
I remember, yeah.
Yeah, so they have, when you go to PCA Cigar Convention, they have like Sutliff company and then corners of it, these micro companies of cigars that they distribute. And I'm wondering is this a play to like keep up with that? Like, is that kind
diversify
of
diversify and also kind of compete with mm-hmm, another? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting.
So, what I will say is that Cornell and Deal, the pipe tobacco that they have, it's actually up here. The pipe tobacco that they have is one of the better, like, I say higher quality tobaccos. We carry them. They're also the pipe tobacco used in like Dunbarton Stillwell Star. They have a hand in the cigar world a little bit. And really good reputation. So this is really interesting. Let's see here. Jack is saying, yeah, getting that little bit of peanutiness at the back of the palate. Okay. Interesting. Interesting. So kind of looking into the article of Half Wheel that wrote on it. Here's a quote from Robert Caldwell saying, "We have been more than fortunate to have had an amazing first 10 years. As we enter our next decade, we want to build on our rookie season with new partners that can help us continue to build and grow on stronger foundation. Laudacy has everything that we need to guarantee the continued success." And there's usually two ways that an acquisition can go. The most common ways, I feel like, a company just completely like envelops another and goes with a whole new style, a new factory, but they just own the brand.
Yeah.
Now, this is a bit different because they own not just the brand, but the company with it. And Caldwell ended up taking a few stock in the company, Laudacy, as well.
Okay.
Hopefully, it's a situation where if Caldwell cigars continue on, like at the PCA trade show, they're actually going to be at Laudacy's booth. Like, right. it's effective immediately.
Right.
So hopefully we'll still see the same type of blending and the same personality of Caldwell behind his cigars. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. You never know how this is going to go.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what has your thoughts been on Caldwell? And also for you guys, drop your comments in. What are your opinions on Caldwell cigars? Are they a brand you enjoy? You thought you didn't enjoy? What do you think?
I've generally enjoyed almost everything. I think they're kind of like a wild card.
Still. They are.
You know, they still maintain that, you know.
Just lost the ash.
Very inventive, but, you know, unpredictable.
Yes. Yes.
Vibe. I really liked, was it Long Live the Queen?
Yeah, the Cameroon.
Yeah, I liked that a lot.
And I find that interesting because Long Live the Queen 2, especially coming off this year, got a lot of recognition. It was on a lot of like top brand lists. Mm-hmm. It was all over the place. I think it was even on Half Wheel. Really good cigar. I think the only thing that it negative had toward it was a little bit pricey.
Yeah.
But really good cigar.
It was. I mean, but they kind of, in terms of presentation, it looks like a cigar you would expect to be.
Yes.
Pricey. You know what I mean?
I could
like
see
it's
that.
Like
yeah.
it's the illustration is beautiful, the presentation is beautiful. So it's like I think I could see that doing well in that mm-hmm. niche, you know.
Yes, that's true. I think especially when like certain companies come out with more expensive cigars, you always wonder like, well, you're kind of known as the mid-range uh-huh. company. Can you really do something that's a sports car? And in that case, I think it works.
I think the other part to consider too is that is it about reach and distribution in terms of like we're in California, that's a difficult state to stock something like Caldwell.
Right? True.
We've done it, but was that I can't remember for sure if we had any difficulty getting distribution on it.
Not as much. I feel like though Caldwell kind of has a bigger following on the East Coast.
So maybe that's part of it too, is that there's an attempt to expand.
Yeah. Yeah. So interesting stuff. I'm always curious when an acquisition happens. You never really fully know why. I think the one that like really like shell shocked everyone was when Matt Booth got bought out. But I will say, like, as much as it's difficult to as a smaller company to coexist and work with a bigger company like General, his fingerprints have still been all over his brands.
Yeah.
The blending style is the same. So it was good to see like Room 101 not getting like
it's
Frankenstein
still kind of,
out.
It's voice one out.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Which too, if you're a company who buys Matt Booth's company.
I feel like you have to know Matt Booth is still going to have a pretty strong
yeah,
voice.
Like you don't want to alienate your fan base.
No.
And so it's more than just a brand. Let's see here. So Kyle is saying, I really love the pepper cream soda line. Yeah, that was good. The peanut butter cup, which I actually never got to try. Scooby Snacks and Bambi from the Lost and Found series. But my favorite regular production is Blind Man's Bluff. Yeah, I think Blind Man, especially for the price on that, is a solid cigar. I was always quite partial to the tea, the Maduro, the Habano, even the Connecticut. Really good collaboration on that. Let's see here. Cigar companies do excellent presentation on products, but I really dig the pre-release label of the Shafio Cigar Clowns Goldie for the Society. It was so raw, really felt that specialty. Awesome.
Very cool.
Cool. And
that's a cool perspective to hear because I think we have this tendency to be like, because sometimes if we get something that's kind of a scoop, you know what I mean? I don't know if scoop is the right word, but an exclusive, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? And we have this worry that it's like, if we aren't presenting it like as the way it will be finished through the main company or whatever, mm-hmm. Are people not going to get the full experience or feel like they enjoy it as much? But there is something kind of exciting about the Society. And then it's like, oh, this is us first. You know what I mean? Like we get this first try at it and it feels like you're, I think that raw, what he's talking about is like you feel like you're part of the process.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like you feel like you're part of that scoop. You're part of that, you know, insider, you know, moment.
Yeah,
you know
yeah,
what I
no,
mean?
Like, I would agree. I mean, it's kind of like we did Silver Blaze and the Paul Stulak last year, because those labels, those white labels are basically what you would see in a factory, probably more handwritten, but it has that raw factory feel.
Yeah.
And I think the only downside when you present a cigar like that for people who are very visual based, they see that and they think, is this a bundle cigar? Is this or this or that?
But the more you know about cigars, the more you know.
Yeah.
That's,
yeah.
You
and
know.
So I appreciate Jack for you saying that because that is kind of the intent to kind of have that raw like factory feel to it. So definitely. Raider Dave is saying, I'm not typically a fan of Caldwell cigars. I've always gotten a dominant hay or barnyard note on them, but Long Live the King is one of my absolute favorites. Yes, especially that Mad Mofo, like San Andreas Maduro one. That's a good cigar. I'm going to have to be right back. Okay.
Real quick.
Okay. Mallory will be right back. So kind of getting into the other side here, I'm going to have to agree with you, Jack. I'm definitely getting that peanut buttery note. Like, that's definitely there. I can taste it on the back end, the finish. So really cool. It's like a muted sweetness. It's not something I would be like, this is really sweet, but it's there. Let's see here. Mitch is saying the tea is absolutely amazing, but my wife and I were chatting. We have never had a bad OGT cigar society. You guys rock it. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. It's one of those things that we definitely want to continue to. I think everyone will say, you know, we're always topping the next month and we're always doing that. But there is a standard we want to uphold to when it comes to the society. And I personally feel like you're the Smoky Lizard is right in that side. With that said, a moment in time, I was looking back and, last year, the cigar that we dropped was the Habano from AJ Fernandez, which was the Fistful of Smoke, which I really loved. I thought it was a great construction, great smoke output, but honestly, I kind of feel like You're the Smoky Lizard for a Habano has a bit more character to it. I think it speaks more in the smoke production, the construction, all those things. So I still loved that cigar. But I think this kind of hits on another level here. So with Laudacy acquiring Caldwell Cigars, then that gets taken over, and they also take over Lost and Found. The interesting thing is that Lost and Found, that subsidiary of Caldwell Cigars, is not only owned by Robert Caldwell, but also a fellow by the name of Tony Botello and Jacqueline Sears, which, as I understand it, Sears was more of the like creative side of Lost and Found, while like the blending style and such like that might have been more on Tony and Roberts. And I don't know if Sears and Tony are still involved in Laudacy or such like that. I partly wonder too, with the acquisition, if it had anything to do with the unfortunate fire for Adventura, because I know that Caldwell had a lot of stock and cigars at the factory, unfortunately, when that burned down. So I don't know if that acquisition has kind of helped that. You hear a lot of stories in the industry about this being a like very friend slash family like type of environment. And it's cool to see that play out once in a while. Like when that fire happened, Caldwell was able to work with AJ, and AJ was able to recreate the tea after it had been gone, I think for like 2 or 3 years, to kind of help out production and Caldwell as a whole. So something like that I thought was really cool for sure. Let's see here. Kyle saying, yes, you're exactly right. Fistful was a great cigar, but the complexity of Smoky Lizard has more mature characteristics to it. I would agree too. I also like the Vitura, also like the shade of it, like the texture of the cigar as well. It's something I really enjoy. Mitch is saying, Fistful of Smoke was my first drop. Happy 1 year together, OGT. Awesome. Yeah. Man, it goes by fast. But yeah, if you notice like the texture on You're the Smoky Lizard, that veiny, some of them pretty toothy, I don't know. It has a lot more maturity to it and a lot more flavor. And I also feel like this would go well with like a cappuccino or something like that. I need to try it. I smoked it with black coffee, which I usually do for a lot of these blends. And it seemed to work, but I think like a little bit added sweetness makes me want to try that. But yeah, smoke output is great. Right now, that lemon zest is still there. I would say it's also got that bready component, a little bit of that peanut butter, and wood, like wood on the retro, maybe a little bit of like white pepper. Let's see here. Gabriel saying, ever pair with mezcal? Yes. In fact, mezcal, we did a summer pairing. What did we pair it with? I think we paired it with a Habano from AJ. And it seemed to work because it wasn't that kind of earthy element. It was more brighter in like nature, the cigar. And it kind of worked with that. And I know that some people, things like mezcal, things like tequila and maybe an Islay Scotch can be really polarizing. When it goes wrong, it goes wrong. But there are some times that it actually works. It kind of works together. Let's see. Matthew is saying, agree with Jack regarding Goldie and the branding, which was a great stick. Also, looking forward to trying the Bloody Knuckle, which is in my humidor. Awesome. Yes. Fantastic cigar. That was, I think, our number two. Yeah, number two cigar year of last year. That new Brazilian Modafina. I love the flavor aspect of it. More cigars. I wish more cigars would use Brazilian Modafina. It's not the easiest to get a hold of, but it just, anytime that comes out, like, it's great. It's great. So I hope you enjoy it, Matthew. You're in for a treat. Let's see. Kyle saying, try it with a cup of Pete's coffee, Major Dixon's blend with a little sugar. Mic drop. Boom. There you go. I'm going to have to try that. I'm going to have to try that for sure. Major Dixon, is that like a darker roast? Is that a breakfast blend? A lighter roast, medium? Where does that lie? That little bit of pepper on the retro that's still there, that I think just makes this cigar. I think too, when I think back to a cigar that like I could smoke anytime during the day, enjoy it every time I like light it up and such, that was, I would say the Elixir or something like Now I Have a Machine Gun that we released during Christmas. Those are also cigars that I'm like always like I could smoke this at any time. It's not too heavy, but it keeps it involved, keeps it busy. It's great. Dark roast. Awesome. I'm going to have to look that up. I have not really tried the full extent of Pete's Coffee. We have friends, which is really cool. They are like micro roasters and they brew their own coffee here in our hometown of Yucaipa. And they do a lot of like Instagram, like DM us and then we'll ship you the coffee and such. It's called Cafecito Coronado. Really good, really good coffee. And they source all their stuff from a farm in Honduras. And it's funny. I was having a conversation the other day with someone at the shop. Apparently, the coffee industry has a very acute similarity to the cigar industry where there's a lot of people that will be like, slap a name on their coffee and try to sell it and get it out there. They don't do their own roasting. They don't really do their own sourcing. They just say, oh, I just know this and we're going to put our name on it. Which inherently there's nothing wrong with that, but I feel like there's an added layer when it's really cool when you're involved in the process or when you have that personal relationship with the farm or such like that. So it's cool. They get their beans sourced from the farm that they are planning on visiting, but they've talked back and forth, but they do all their own micro roasting. And they've got some really good like coffees. If you like to do coffee and cigars, see here, speaking of the Bloody Knuckle, the uppercut is an awesome turned up version of the original great cigar. Awesome. I figured Raider Dave, you'd enjoy it. I know that you're a huge fan of it. Like myself. It's like a dessert. It's like a espresso powder, leathery dessert cigar. We paired it with, on Friday, we did it with Balcones single malt from Texas. And like the fruity sweetness from that worked with like the sweetness. I find this one to be a little more sweet than the previous, but it just worked together. And I'm like, man, you just want to like eat the cigar. It's just really good. Let's see. Duck Commander now roasts and blends coffee. Awesome. I have to look into that as well. And you hear people say it all the time with like certain cigars, like there's so many, how do you get to try this and this? When you become obsessed with it, you become obsessed and somehow those cigars find their way into your humidor. Coffee, I feel like though, I'm on the outside right now. I'm like, there are so many, whether it's coffee, whether it's wine. I've dipped my toe a little bit into bourbon, a little bit into scotch, where I can kind of be like, yeah, I've tried a decent amount. There's still tons I haven't, but coffee and wine is still one I have yet to begin that journey. I'll have to send you a collab coffee with Youngstown Coffee Company and Caldwell. They roast it right here in the facility behind Tony Bellotto's dad's cigar lounge. Really? That sounds awesome. Yeah, I would love to try that. I think Black Label too has their own like line of coffee as well. Interesting. Let's see here. I can see this with a Peruvian coffee blend. Okay. But I'm pairing this with Blanton's. Oh, well, there you go. And it's not overpowering, but accentuating the cherry flavor in the juice along with lemon peel raspberry on point. Sweet. Sounds like a great pairing. Just order the weekend sampler with the Bloody Knuckle. Can't wait. I hear nothing but good on that. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for that support. And yes, it is included in there as well as the El Oso Warped, which is a fantastic, fantastic cigar. That's like one of those like elevated smooth, rich flavored cigars. That's really good. Modern Times has some fantastic bourbon barrel aged beans. Probs work well with the stick. Yeah, I could definitely see that. I've tried a few. I don't know if anyone's tried from Bones, but Bones makes some really good. Like there's an Ecuador, Ethiopian and a Sumatra. Those have gone really well with Aganorsa tobacco. And we got Jim saying coffee addict. Yeah. And when you get bit by the bug, whether it's cigars, whether it's bourbons or coffee or tea or whatever it is, it definitely becomes an obsession. Like before we owned the shop, I started with a small 100 count desktop humidor made by Savoy. And I was like, this is 100 count. So you could probably fit like 60 or 70 cigars. That's going to be too much room. I don't know if I can fill it up. Well, fast forward 3 months later, it ended up being two of those humidors. Fast forward a little bit longer, it was a coolador, and then it turned into a 6-foot cabinet, which my wife nicknamed the second wife. It starts that bunny trail all the way down, and it just, people are like, so it's a hobby? It's like, yeah, it's a hobby. It's also an obsession, and I don't know if it's a good thing or not. In my opinion, it is. But in 2 weeks, we have the PCA trade show coming up. And for those who don't know what the PCA trade show is, it is a cigar trade show for people within the industry, whether it's media, whether it's retail shops, whether it's manufacturers, brands. And this is when you see a lot of new products coming out. You see a lot of projects that maybe have been teased on social media or press releases. There's several that we've got our sights on that look really interesting. But one that was pre-released before PCA was Crown Heads Blood Medicine. Now, I don't know if you guys have tried the cigar. It's an Ecuadorian Habano. Crown Heads has continued to impress me. We recently brought them in. Their new Mil Diaz Maduro is on point. Yellow Rose Tennessee Waltz. Juarez, which is like a cigar that smokes way above its price point. So Blood Medicine originally was an event-only cigar. You could only get your hands on the cigar if like, a Crown Heads did an official event at your store, and now it's being released worldwide. So you're going to be seeing that coming in really soon. I've heard nothing but great things. It's one of the bucket list Crown Head cigars that I've been wanting to try. So really looking forward to it. Let's see here. Gabriel saying SHOT Show for cigars. 100%. In fact, a friend of mine at the shop goes to SHOT Show every year, and we always talk about similarities. Just today we were talking about it. Joshua saying, I'm definitely looking forward to the PCA and seeing what's new. Yes, 100%. I know that we got a new Broadleaf coming from HVC, Black Label Trading, or I should say Blackwork Studio. They've got a new release coming. So looking forward to it. Let's see here. The new Tatawahe, my father, addict. Tatawahe, is a great brand too. My father, like similar type of blends that you see come out of there, but on point. Joshua saying Blood Medicine is a very nice cigar. 100%. Raider Dave is saying, Eric, I'll be in Vegas PCA weekend. We've got to get together for a cigar. Oh, 100%. We should. Definitely. I didn't know you're going to be out there. Yeah. We'll have to hit each other up. We got to make it happen. Jack is saying, I'm also looking forward to that Mil Diaz. Yes. That Mil Diaz is really good. And it's a different take on Connecticut Broadleaf. And for me, Connecticut Broadleaf is one of my favorites in terms of Maduros. I mean, I love a good San Andreas. Matafina is also really up there. And something I wish I could see a bit more, and hopefully we'll have a bit more coming, is Pennsylvania Broadleaf. Pennsylvania Broadleaf, I feel like, gets a bad rep because it's kind of the ugly stepchild of Connecticut Broadleaf. And it's not one of those tobaccos that I think just works inherently like some Maduro wrappers out there. But when it's done right, I really like what it has to offer. Like Jacob Slatter, whether it's Brimstone or the original by Southern Draw, that's a fantastic cigar. That's a great Pennsylvania Broadleaf. If you guys have had the new Bishop's Blend, Novem Dialis, that Black Label did, great Pennsylvania Broadleaf. So it can be done right. I just feel like it gets a bad rep and you don't see it as common. But great tobacco. I think the common problem that I've seen it when it's gone wrong in blends is when it's not smoothed out by the inside tobacco, by the filler tobacco, and it just has a very bitter, like that's like the main overbearing note. While bitter, I think, works in a good balance. If you've got a lot of good like coffee tones and sweet notes, you kind of want a grounding like back end of like bitterness. But when that's like the forward flavor, that's when I think it's like, yeah, this is not going to work. So hopefully coming up soon, we'll be able to see more Pennsylvania broadleaf stuff coming out there. And whenever Black Label slaps it on a cigar, it seems to work. They did it with Memento Mori, Novem Dialis. Great stuff. So final third here, white pepper's kind of kicked up a little bit. There's a touch more earthiness, I feel like, in the final third, and more wood. Some of that lemon peel, lemon pith that we were talking about, I feel it's kind of taken a back seat. There's still a residual sweetness, but if for me, that sweetness is more like burnt pie crust, almost sweetness, to where it's like, yeah, it's in there. It's a little buried in between the other stuff, but it's kind of a complimentary note on the back end. But I feel like deeper tones are happening towards the end. I haven't gotten any bitterness from this so far, but as soon as we work that.
All right.
And she's back.
Yeah. Sorry. If you had any doubt that this is a family show, I have to go pick up our kids from extracurriculars in the middle of a life. So.
This is basically as mom and pop as it gets. So.
Yeah. Literal mom.
Let's see. Jack saying, I'm the founder of Liquid and Leaf Lifestyle. Super new. I will definitely have to get an interview with you and something that of that nature. You have a great insight into these great boutique cigars. Well, I really appreciate it. And that would be great. I'd love to do that. That would be cool. We can talk about pairings, what's worked, what hasn't worked. What I can tell you what did not work is there was one time many years ago, I had a Padron with a double pour of straight gin.
Seems like that would be a bad idea.
Didn't work. Sure. There was nothing else in the house. I was like, yeah, it probably works. It's summertime. Welcome back from Kyle. Texas Taurus, is that your sister? No, it is not. No, it is not.
Unless I check.
And I'm going to go ahead and pull the band off here. Yeah,
we're not that mom and pop.
No. We're into our final third there for Year of the Smoky Lizard. For me, as I was saying, it's less brighter notes. It's more like,
well, hold on. I'm not caught up with you yet. So hold on.
At least where I'm at.
I feel like I get some leathery at this point.
I can see some leather in there. Yeah. Yeah. It's more woody to me. And I was saying for sweetness, I find it to be a bit more like burnt pie crust sweetness, a touch. Let's see here. We got Raider Dave saying gin with anything. So unfortunately, like I'd say this changed about 7 years ago. I used to really, really enjoy gin. Mm-hmm. Like I still enjoy the flavor.
I love gin.
But something happened. I don't know quite why, but like I ended up drinking a healthy amount of gin one night, hanging out with a friend of mine named Oz. And then I went home and I caught a stomach bug the next day. And ever since then, even the smallest amount, I'm like, whoa.
Ruin everything.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. But I liked it. Texas Taurus is saying gin is crap. I mean, it's definitely acquired taste. It's definitely acquired taste. Let's see here. We got Cal saying, nah, it isn't. Just got to find the right gin. I mean, I would agree with you.
This is not I don't think it's a flavor thing for you. You like the flavor.
I love it.
I think it's just you just had a bad experience.
Yeah. And like a gin that still, like I can still taste it. Sticks in my mind is, I think it's called Old Raj. It's RA-J. That is, it's a pricier gin. It's in like the $50, which is normally not a gin price. But
you got me Ada Lovelace gin.
Yeah. Yeah.
A couple years ago, and that was very good. I like the Botanist too. I like the more floral. I like floral in general.
Let's see here. We got Texas Taurus gin and juice. The most I used to do is I would take a wedge of lime, squeeze it into the gin, and drop it.
My favorite is gin and a little bit of Saint Germain and absinthe and cucumber and lime.
Yeah, and absinthe. But yeah, no, it's a refreshing drink.
Absinthe and gin though is a really like it's a destructive choice. Like you have to know you're gonna have a bad morning.
True,
but like it's worth it.
It's worth the sacrifice. let's see here. Raider Dave saying it's called growing up, Eric. You leveled up to whiskey. Well, actually, I started with whiskey. The first scotch that I ever had was Laphroaig me not knowing anything about Scotch, I was like, oh, this is what Scotch tastes like. And like, didn't know regions, differences and such like that. But yeah, let's see here. Mitch is saying, just finished mine. No gin for me. I drank gin, then too much gin, then had bad experience. Headed to bed, night all. Thanks so much, Mitch. Thanks for jumping on. Have a great night. Let's see here. Gabriel saying Saint Germain is super floral and very tasty.
So I will be happy when we can find a cigar that pairs well with something like Saint Germain, because I love a floral cigar and I feel like there are not enough.
Like, we'll have to call it like summer roses or something like that. let's see here. Jack saying, I'm not a super big fan of gin myself, but some people do appreciate it. That's what Liquid and Leaf is, finding something you like and share the experience and celebrate that. Spirits, coffee, tea, and cigars.
Very cool.
You've been really heavy into tea recently.
Yes, I have been. And it's weird because I've never been a tea drinker. And for some reason, this year is the year of tea for me. I've been making chai, like
good stuff
from scratch chai.
Yeah. See, Texas Taurus saying, absinthe messed me up bad. Got into a flight, but there was three of them. Didn't end well, but didn't feel anything. Well, there you go.
That's a strategy.
That's usually our old like tradition for Valentine's Day, because our eldest daughter was born on Valentine's. Mm-hmm. So that takes up most of the day. So, but by the time all the kids are in bed, we used to have a tradition where we get a bottle of gin and just kind of stay up late. A bottle of absinthe. Absinthe. Yeah.
Yeah, and just sit and drink absinthe. Yeah.
Just a little dangerous. Yeah.
Join late. What?
Oh, okay. DEA saying, join late. What are you smoking? We are smoking the Year of the Smoky Lizard, which is the OGT Cigar Society drop of this month, which we have a few spots open left. If you have the opportunity, jump on this before the membership closes. Fantastic. Habano 2000 from Nicaragua. Love this stick. So.
I think I get a little more herbal or vegetal.
Yeah. Cal saying the green fairy can be dangerous.
We haven't even tried the European kind.
With like wormwood or whatever.
The hallucinogenic thing. Yeah. Haven't done that.
I do feel like when it comes to absinthe, though, there's a lot of misconceptions. They're like,
well, I think because, well, the initial absinthe, the bohemian absinthe actually does have some, hallucinogenic qualities with the wormwood and stuff. So people would supposedly have some kind of reaction to it. But the absinthe that we have here, readily available in America, is just very strong.
Yeah.
So you're going to have an interesting evening, but I don't think you're actually going to see the green fairy.
Right.
Unless.
Right. Yeah. Let's see here. Rich is saying, pairing with this Eagle Rare, absolutely great. Highly recommend this. Awesome. Awesome. Well, guys, we're coming down to the end here. And so going forward, so everyone's on the same plane, is we used to meet the first Thursday of every month for Society at 7:00, just kind of the way the schedule with the shop works. We're actually moving it back to Wednesday so we can meet a bit earlier. People on the West Coast or in the Midwest can actually meet at a decent time. And it's not starting now when it's 10:00 going into 11 and it's a weekday and such like that. So it's been awesome to hang out with you guys and have more people kind of just chime in and on comments and such like that.
It's been really good.
Yeah. At the end of the day, this is what this is about. The Society is about. So thank you guys so much for joining on.
Yeah. Let's see here.
I came in too late. Just got back from the pub. Hope everyone is doing well. Definitely. Let's see here. Absinthe makes the heart grow fonder, but I'm pretty sure that that's saying. And I mean, Kyle, I know hopefully it's easier for you. I know that like a lot of us with work jobs and such like that in between, it doesn't go too late. But
yeah,
it was awesome hanging out with you guys. We have another drop coming for Society in just several weeks here. Really exciting. This is going to be a little bit different than what we've done before. Very, very different. But I think everyone's going to enjoy it. It's going to be an awesome experience. But thank you guys for jumping on. We will see you next Wednesday. But also check out the Friday drop for Bleak Midwinter 2.
Next month, next Wednesday.
Sorry. Yes.
You're thinking of the podcast.
I am.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. A month from now.
Wednesday. A month from now, Wednesday.
But on Friday at 7:00, we drop Bleak Midwinter 2. Don't sleep on that. So.
Oh, how do we join?
So DEA on how to join. So unfortunately with YouTube, you can't actually put links and such like that. But if you go to our website, which I will not name, We don't want any dings. But if you follow breadcrumbs, you can find on the landing page on the header, has OGT Cigar Society. Please do join us, become a member. We get a 5-pack of a custom blend that we feel like really is kind of stands out amongst a lot of the things in the industry, kind of highlights the talents of boutique companies that we carry and some of the talents of people that we are in the future going to be working with. It's a really, really great cigar. So if you get an opportunity, please do join the membership, join the community. And thank you guys for joining on. Everyone have a great night. Thanks for smoking with us on our